We're now going to begin our first panel of the day, but first I'd like to introduce you to a lady who is one of the key people in the climate change agenda. She is the Executive Director of Climate Finance for the Climate Policy Initiative. A very warm welcome, please, for Barbara Buchner.
Thank you very much, and good morning to everyone, and thank you so much for joining us here to hear this esteemed panel that I'm lucky to moderate, to really discuss what are effective government strategies for implementing the Paris Climate Agreement. Again, I am delighted to be here and be serving as a moderator, and I do think that we are facing an historic momentum at the moment. I mean, the Paris Agreement has marked a turning point for global climate action, but in order to really implement it and to really get us on a low-carbon climate resilient pathway, what we need to do is really requiring economy-wide transformations and also requiring the channeling of both public and private finance into low-carbon climate resilient activities. And this will only happen if governments, industry, and businesses work together. So today, a little more after a year of the Paris Agreement, I think it's the right time to really take stock of how governments are making progress towards implementing their goals and towards implementing their national determined contributions. And what we can see here is actually a fantastic panel that really provides a lot of experience and a lot of concrete action that can help us think about the urgency of action and the ways of bringing together the public and the private sector to get us onto this pathway. The World Future Energy Summit, which brought together governments, with industry leaders, with corporate decision makers, with entrepreneurs and with investors, is the perfect place to discuss these issues. I think there is no one better than Felipe Calderon to help us set the scene and really understand how we can think big in getting us towards a low-carbon climate resilient pathway. Let me just briefly introduce Felipe. Felipe Calderon, as you all know, served as the president of Mexico from 2006 to 2012. Prior to his presidency, he was secretary of energy and director of Panobras, and he currently is the president of the Sustainable Human Development Foundation, member of the board of directors of the World Resources Institute, and of course, chairman of the Global Commission for Energy, Economy and Climate, which obviously has, you know, provided a lot of very important substance and technical help in order of thinking on how we can actually grasp the opportunities that the global transition towards a below 2 degrees pathway will provide to us. So with that, Felipe, may I give the floor to you for your keynote speech.
Thank you. Thank you, Barbara, for your generous word. Your Highness, ladies and gentlemen, Your Excellencies, good morning. It's fantastic to be here. And of course, after what happened in Paris more than 1 year ago, even more. The Paris Agreement has set a great turning point in the most global challenge we face as humanity, climate change. However, to be honest, we are far away from our goal. Yes, we have the agreements. Now we need to go to the facts, which is the difficult part of this. And we need to put in place all we have committed. And even if all the NDCs, the nationally determined contributions, are fulfilled, if all those NDCs are achieved, that is still not enough to keep global temperature below 2 degrees. So there is still a lot of work to do. What can we do from the perspective of governments, and not only government, but from the perspective of leadership? Probably, in my opinion, the most important thing is to put in place the right economic incentives. If I can pick one single thing to do, is that. Provide to the consumers, to the producers, to the companies, to the governments even, the right market signals to do the right things. And that means to remove, and once for all, the fossil fuel subsidies everywhere. And second, pricing carbon, whatever could be the specific measure to do it, could be among the most important things could be done by governments, public policy makers. And that is the answer to the question of what to do, but a real issue is how to do it. And what I can anticipate to this panel is we need to minimize the social and political cost associated with such transition. Why? Because, of course, one size doesn't fit everything, doesn't fit all. Every country is different, and any circumstances are different. But it is important either to compensate all those people who can lose and try to design like a fair transition to the new regime of the right economic incentives. It could be like compensating the poor people in the societies with other direct transfer mechanism, or it could be implementing these kind of changes in prices gradually over the time. It could be several ways to do that, but it is important to maximize the change in economic incentives by minimizing the political and social cost associated. Second, it is crucial to plan much better how we can use our resources. So planning is crucial. So we need to change. We need to change the way in which we plan and we build our cities. For instance, it is of the utmost importance to stop this model of sprawling cities everywhere. We cannot continue this way in which we are designing an inhuman development of the cities. We need to change the way in which we produce and use energy, and I congratulate Masdar and the Emirates for, and Abu Dhabi, of course, for the incredible, well-done job you are doing. And we need to change the way in which we transport people, we transport goods. We need to change this model based in the use of individual cards and jump into a new model based on the sustainable massive transportation means. We need to plan and change the way in which we manage agricultural sector, we manage the landscapes, mainly the forests in particular in developing countries. So we'll need to do a lot by planning the right thing. And third, it is not enough to plan, of course, how to implement those plans. And to plan and to implement them, it is crucial as well, we also have to know how to act. And for this, we need the best possible advice from multilateral institutions, for instance, for international financial institutions that can see the big picture and have experience making economic change happen on the ground. That's why, of course, you can name your favorite, I can name my own favorite. I'm talking about international financial institutions. I think the World Bank has an incredible experience. There are several regional development banks. I had the opportunity to chair one of them with Banobras in Mexico, fantastic. But the point is we need to use in the best way our scarce resources. And to do that, we need the best advice. But the best way to do this is training people. We need to invest in the people who are able to design the plans and to put in place the projects. One of the bottlenecks we can observe, for instance, financing sustainable development, financing the change, is the lack of viable projects, the lack of bankable projects everywhere. Actually, the paradox is there is a lot of money coming from capital funds, governments, mutual funds, pension funds everywhere, looking for green projects, but there are not enough bankable projects in all those developing countries. And one of the problems of this bottleneck is there are not enough prepared people to design and to implement and to attract those projects. So strong recommendations is we need to invest in investment. We need to invest in the people. We need to prepare all those kids with technical skills. We need to prepare, for instance, engineers with financial capabilities. We need to prepare scientists. We need to prepare lawyers with financial capabilities to design a viable project, a project finance project, a project which is good for the environment, but also good for the economy and for the companies as well. It's able to reduce carbon emission, but it's also able to produce profits for a company or a community. Now, there are very positive changes recently that we should celebrate. First is, despite recent and current events, in particular in the political arena, and in particular in a very big country to the north of Mexico, I cannot remember exactly what is happening there, but there are some changes in the political arena right now. I do believe the rising public climate concerns open an incredible window of opportunity for change. So we need to take advantage of this window of opportunity. Second, as we all know, there has been huge progress in prices for renewable energy, and I feel that we may have crossed the barrier, and they can no longer be stopped since their prices have decreased so much. Look at this. Today, solar prices, for instance, are about 90% cheaper, 90% cheaper than 10 years ago. I was Secretary of Energy 2003-2004, a long time ago, not too much, but anyway, 12 years ago, 13 years ago, and the point is, when we were talking about solar energy, wind energy, everybody said it's like a naive proposal of the minister, it's like a naive dream, it's like a philanthropic issue, whatever. No, it is not. Now it's a real business. As His Eminence said, the president and director of Mazars said a few minutes ago, the price of kilowatt hour is roughly 3 cents. It was the same here in the Emirates, was the price of the bid in Mexico, was the price in Chile. Look at this. Through 2016 only, we saw auctions in different places breaking records for the lowest cost of renewable one after the other. The record by the end of this year, the last year, was almost 40% lower than the price at the beginning of the year. That's a change. And moreover, it is increasingly clear that there are many other business opportunities arising from the transition towards clean energy sources. And that is exactly what we call the new climate economy. That it is possible to get real business and profits and at the same time to reduce carbon emissions. And that is good for societies, governments, and companies. And that's the reason several of those 100 of exhibitors here are looking for those investment opportunities, because today the real change is doing the right thing, reducing carbon emissions, could provoke very well, meaning and talking about businesses. Well, according to a report just published by the Business and Sustainable Development Commission, now these days in Davos, pursuing sustainable development could open up a $12 trillion opportunities, $12 trillion opportunity by 2030. And that is just in four areas: energy, cities, agriculture, and health. Businesses and investors are realizing the scale of the transition. Look at this, it's quite impressive. During the third quarter of 2016, only 3 months, gigawatts of solar power was installed. More than four gigawatts of solar power were installed in the U.S. 4 gigawatts. That is equivalent to connect one home in the United States every 11 seconds in the U.S. So major companies like Unilever, Coca-Cola, and PepsiCo have joined the Tropical Forest Alliance 2020, committed to reduce deforestation. So businesses that lead the transition will do better. Look at the case of Tesla. It's not a bright idea to have electric vehicles. The point is Tesla is making profits. So the capital value of Tesla is several times the capital value of GM or Ford Motor Company or other companies making mistakes, not investing in the right places like Mexico. But the point is there are real business in renewable energy and electric vehicles. You can pick any other examples. I'm not talking about only industry or transportation. Look at this in developing countries, forest, our plantations. You want to plant teak, for instance, in Mexico. At least the rate of return of tick plantations in Mexico is above 12% a year. So you can get money and at the same time sink carbon on the ground. Nevertheless, politicians cannot leave everything to businesses and multilateral organizations, with all respect. We still need more ambitious political commitment from all national actors. You know, if there is no political willingness in the leadership in one single country, there is no point. There is no success. We need political willingness and real commitment from the leadership, from the top of the pyramid of power. So there are many leaders that are not yet aware of the huge economic opportunities in this transition and how important it is for the globe to change right now. We need to spread the word and persuade those people that it is not only in their human interest to prevent climate change, to mitigate climate change, it is also in their economic self-interest to join the transition. It is not only about how to reduce the threats of climate change, it's about how to build a stronger economy everywhere. It's about how to alleviate poverty, and it's about how to increase the number of jobs everywhere. There is a huge discussion, for instance, in the United States, talking about the political presidential campaign, the past campaign, talking about the number of jobs threatened by the coal mining. And yes, we need to design a fair transition for all those workers. But look at this. In the coal mining, there are less than 70,000 jobs. Do you know how many jobs have been created in solar energy in the United States? More than 200,000, 200,000 vis-a-vis 70,000 in the coal mining. So the new economy is there, the new jobs are there, and we need to create and to foster the new economy instead to stop and blocking what is happening everywhere. So we also need to spread the message that we need to create the right policies, the right economic incentives, the right signals to the market, that those that set the right incentives for different actors. This will be particularly important to steer the world away from coal. We need to be pragmatic. We can prioritize. We need to move away from coal everywhere. So moving away from coal is indeed costly, or it is complicated, I would say, because if you consider the externalities and the externalities associated with coal, generating electricity with coal is much more expensive than a lot of renewable sources. But we need to design a fair transition for countries. For instance, countries like China, countries like India, countries like Indonesia or Turkey. It is important to design the right incentives and the fair transitions to move them, to move those governments to take steps away from coal. Coal accounts for 41% of global electricity production, but contributes to more than 70% of global emissions in power generation. So we need to phase it out quickly, and if we generate the right incentives, we will make fossil-free energy even more and more competitive. Some countries have, of course, a much clearer strategy already in motion. Others, however, need a lot of help urgently. So we need to move quickly to help them. One important way will be to identify and spread the successful experiences and replicable projects already in place that can quickly be adjusted and adopted elsewhere. That is why this week, Sustainable Week in Abu Dhabi, is so, so important. Throughout our time here, we'll be hearing about many such projects that are already happening, that can be spread and scaled, that can influence policies and change the economic order. I'm impressed and delighted by the strong commitment already shown by our hosts and friends, the United Arab Emirates, and their leaderships. And I encourage all of you to keep up your efforts in changing your energy from brown to green and showing all the many benefits that brings. We have spent too much time talking about the dangers of climate change. and not nearly enough about the benefits of going green. In other words, it's time to stop talking about the hell of global warming and to start saying much more about the opportunities to be found in the promised land of the new climate economy. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for setting the scene for this panel discussion and providing, as always, a very inspiring, you know, overall kind of speech on not only the urgency for action and, you know, the urgency of getting economic incentives right and getting the planning right, but also that getting the implementation of the plans right, but also outlining the real huge economic opportunities that, you know, a new economy, a low-carbon, climate-resilient transformation has. So thank you so much for that. And with that, now I'm very delighted to be inviting my panel to join me here. And let me just start first with His Excellency Piyush Goyal, who is Minister of State with Independent Charge for Power, Coal, New and Renewable Energy and Mines of the Republic of India. Minister. And next, I'd be delighted to invite Adnan Amin, who is the Director General of IRENA, and obviously very well known to everyone here, to join us on the panel. Now, I'd like to invite Manuel Pulgar Vidal, who is the Head of Climate and Energy at WWF International, but of course, very well known to all of us as a former Minister of State in Peru and President of the Lima COP. May I invite also you, President Calderon, to join us on the panel again. And last but certainly not least, our very own host again, Mohamed Shamel Al-Ramahi, who is the Chief Executive Officer of Masdar. So unfortunately, we do not have a lot of time for this panel discussion, but I'm very excited to actually continue some of the discussions that and the issues that President Calderon anticipated also in his opening speech about really thinking what are some of the effective government strategies, what are some of the effective strategies to collaborate with industry and really thinking about what's the economic incentives that have worked in specific countries and what can we share in terms of concrete examples. So I'd like to invite every panelist here for a very brief kind of opening speech on the you know experiences around effective strategies and really what can we learn in order to replicate, scale up and spread what is working and getting us towards the overall goals of the Paris Agreement. So Minister Goyal, if I can give you first the word.
Thank you, ma'am. In fact, as my Prime Minister says, government has no business to be in business. And we genuinely believe that if we leave the private sector to run the programs around meeting climate goals set in Paris, we'll be far more successful. But at the same time, there are policy initiatives to be made. There are ways in which government can play a role of a facilitator. And therefore, I would suggest that what the policy we are following in India so far quite successfully has been that it'll have to be a people, private, professor, and policymaker partnership, a 5P partnership. Because at the end of the day, it's the people, the consumer for whom we are doing all of this. We want to leave behind a better planet for the next generation and a better health for the people of the world and for India, a better future for the children of India, and therefore we will have to keep in mind what's most important and paramount for their happiness. It's very important that the private sector runs the program to make it effective, to implement it efficiently, and of course to bring capital, to bring technology and all the enablers to make it successful. Policymakers have to play the role of a facilitator. On a personal note, I have found that whenever we focus on subsidies and too much of government involvement in making these programs scale up, we land up creating more complications and actually become a constraint to the flourishing of that sector. And lastly, I think professors, the academia, can play a huge role to bring in better efficiency, better technology in the system, We are running at 19-20% PLF on solar equipment. I don't know why it can't be much more. We are using 4 or 5 acres of land for every megawatt of solar power. Could we look at more efficient utilization of land? And what Masdar is doing on the concentrated solar power, as it scales up, will of course help to bring down that cost. Also provide 24/7 power, so that the dream of His Excellency, the former President of Mexico, can be met, that coal does not remain as relevant as it is today as a base load. Many things that the academia can really contribute with. And undoubtedly, this partnership of all four stakeholders can truly help us meet the climate goals of Paris. I personally believe that now, with the current economics around renewable energy, we should not even be focusing on meeting these climate goals. It's time we started challenging ourselves to exceeding them, and exceeding them by a mile. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Very inspiring. And I think it is incredible that India, again, is innovative. You're going from a PPP to a 5P. That is certainly something which we all can learn from. But I think also your point on the subsidies, I've seen Betty from Aqua Power here nodding very much. So I think I'd be very curious to hear some of the other experiences of panelists here. With that, let me continue and invite Mr. Anand to provide his perspectives on really what has worked in getting us towards, you know, the Paris Agreement and concrete strategies there.
Thank you. First of all, let me say what a delight it's been to watch Piyush Goyal discuss the question of coal in this forum, and the question of whether it constitutes a baseload. But I think, you know, President Calderon said probably the most fundamental thing in this whole discussion is question of leadership. Because every other ingredient is basically there. And if you look around the world, in the drive to carbonization, there are many sectors. There's land use, there's agriculture, there's all sorts of things. But in the energy field, which we are discussing in this forum, it's very clear that there's an energy transformation going on. And if we are able to accelerate this transformation, if we are able to share technology, find the right business models, financing, and policy frameworks, we have probably the best chance of decarbonization to the point that we can remain below 2 degrees. So our focus is laser-like on that. And why leadership is so important. I had the honor to be invited by Piyush and under the aegis of the Prime Minister of India to the first Reinvest conference that took place last year in India. If you can imagine coming from a very low base that a country suddenly stands up and says it's committing to 175 gigawatts of new renewable power in a very short 7-year time frame, with the 100 coming from solar and 75 from wind and other technologies, that's a remarkable development. And if you look around, you know, coming out of Paris, there was a focus on what is the practical action that can get us there. We have the African Renewable Energy Initiative now. The ambition is to get 300 gigawatts of renewable power in the system by 2030. That will put Africa, which is probably one of the fastest growing in terms of energy demand, onto a sustainable trajectory, because if we don't do that, the availability of new hydrocarbon possibilities in Africa will take Africa in the high carbon direction. And that will have implications for the entire world. That's the same for Asia, it's the same for Latin America. So how do we do this? We've looked, and President Calderon spoke about all of this. I hope he read our research, because we have exactly the same numbers in terms of cost declines in the major technologies, the deployment last 2 years, the new capacity additions to the global power sector, the majority has come from renewables. But there's a lot more to do. We're still at just over 18%. And we believe that we need 36% renewables in the system by 2030 to be within the target for carbon emissions. There are two things that have emerged from our work. There's a multitude of very interesting things that are happening on innovation, policy, and so on. But the two key things are, as Piyush said, the principal actors are going to be the private sector. The governments do not have the public resources that can even achieve 1/20th of what we need to achieve in terms of investment. Investment has to come from the private sector. Everybody talks about the fact that there are $2 trillion sitting at 1% interest looking for avenues to go to. Why is it not happening? That's the first issue. And, you know, it's a double-edged sword. On the one hand, it's a role of governments. If you do not create a long-term, stable regulatory and policy framework where an investor comes, says, one, the ease of doing business in this economy is reducing my cost, and I'm confident that over the next 15 years, I'll be able to recover my investment with the kind of returns I can achieve under this policy regime. If you don't have that confidence, you don't put your money on the table. So the first responsibility is for governments. How do you create a regulatory framework that can enable this higher scale of investment to begin to happen? But then, what are the financial instruments that are going to get us there? One of the things that struck me in the India discussion was the extraordinary impact that currency risk has in terms of raising premiums on financing. We know from the record that the bulk of renewable investment that's taken place is 90 to 95% reliable. There's a very small actual risk premium, but it is overpriced in the financial markets because the cost of capital that is coming into renewables is far too high. So we need to find instruments on how we mitigate this risk. And one of the areas where we're putting a lot of emphasis is what are the kind of international or multilateral risk guarantee mechanisms that we can deploy that can address things like technology risk, policy risk, can address issues of currency risk. Where are the innovative design of these mechanisms that we can bring at scale so that we reduce the cost of capex? The problem with renewables investment, it's not a problem, but the issue with renewables investment is that it's almost 100% upfront. I think every time Paddy gets involved in one investment, he doesn't sleep for a few weeks knowing something can happen with that capex. And there are very few marginal cost additions down the road. So you actually have to recover your 100% over the lifetime of the project, and the cost of capital is really important in that setting. So we need to reduce the cost of capital. But we also need to increase the understanding of what innovation means. Innovation is not just technology. We know that technology is coming. We know that innovations in technology are reducing costs. We know that innovations in the big new emerging field of digitalization of grids, of digitalization of energy, of demand side management, of all of these things, additional storage in the system, etc., it's going to be revolutionary. But we need to get to that point where we can take advantage of this revolutionary development, and that point comes from innovation in policy, it comes from innovation in markets, and it comes from innovation in business models. That's where the real cost reduction is going to come in. Just to give you an example on markets, if you look at the sophistication of the European market today, or at least the German electricity market, German transmission system operators are now operating on 15-minute energy products. There are 1.7 million energy producers in the system. You cannot manage that through a centralized system. It has to be a market. There are 15-minute products in the market, and they are able to handle up to 45, 50% renewables, variable renewables in their system through this market mechanism, which enables them to balance their various sources of energy. And also added to that, the importance of the regional dimension, creating electricity networks that are bigger. You know, if the Germans didn't have access to the rest of Europe and didn't have access to the hydro resources in Scandinavia, it would be immensely difficult to manage their variability in their system. So these are the kind of innovations, the business models that need to be developed further.
Great. Thank you so much. And I think, I couldn't agree more. I think also in our work at CPI, what we see, it is really about first getting the policy environments and the regulatory environments right, but then getting the risks and the returns right for the private sector. And that is by innovating financial solutions, refining financial solutions, thinking about really risk mechanisms. And we've been also working on some FX risk instruments, actually, for India, specifically on that one. But I think that's really something where there is more action needed, and that's what I think links back to the professors as well, where we really need still some more thinking and technical advice. But I couldn't agree more that we really need to focus on innovation in order to close the gap that we have between where we are now in terms of investments that get us towards the right pathway and as you said, also where we really need to be. So with that, I'd be very happy to hear a little bit more from the experiences of Mr. Bulgar Vidal, both obviously in your, you know, experience as also the president of the COP in Lima, but then obviously also the work that you're doing now. Again, it is important to bring the right stakeholders together, so having different types of organizations here on the panel, I think, is really helpful to think what is the, you know, what everyone needs to do in order to get us there.
No, thank you very much. We are here to discuss government strategies in relation to the Paris Agreement. So let me raise some points that I think are key to define that kind of government strategies. First, we are in a time of global political uncertainty. But we do need to be clear that the Paris Agreement and the Paris Agreement process, it is irreversible and unstoppable. And for that, first, what we need to have in our government strategies, it is to put it together, all the pieces, and to talk about development. What we did in the 2015, not only because of the Paris Agreement, but also because of the SDGs, the Addis Ababa Agenda for Financing for Development, and the Sendai Framework for Risk Management, it was all a new paradigm of development. And we do need to include that in our governmental and national planning process. That is the first. But for that, what we do need to have and to move quickly, it is a review of the NDCs. I fully agree with President Calderon that the INDCs are not enough to deal with the threshold of 1.5, 2 degrees. So with the INDCs, we are moving close to 3 degrees. So we do need to raise ambition. But remember that the INDCs was the way to create confidence and trust after the Copenhagen failure. But now we are in a time in which we should move quickly the review of the NDCs. So for us, 2018, because the facilitative dialogue, 2020, because the beginning of the new process for the new NDCs are key. But we do need to move now in a multisectorial way. My third recommendation is to strengthen the climate action agenda. So I'm referring of this strong dialogue between public and non-public, state and non-state actors, in a way that includes sectorial approach. What currently it is happening around the world, it is amazing. The C40 pledges for peaking no after 2020, or the roadmap for transport and mobility, and building and construction, or the pledges related to forestry, are it what we do need to have also in our internal governmental strategies. I need to work with the non-state actors as a way to raise ambition. But also for that, what it is important, it is to have a long-term vision. Because there are some key times. 2020 because of the NDCs. 2030 because it is in most of the cases the deadline of our NDCs. But 2050 as a pathway to define a carbon neutral economy. So it is very, very important what the UAE has just approved, this energy vision, long-term vision for 2050, with this 44% of renewable, but also the Climate Vulnerable Forum with 100% pledges of renewables among some other countries. But also in this long-term vision, what it is important, it is to take decisions about, for example, of the coal, investment on coal, in which there are some countries that has already pledged to phase out of coal investment by 2030, 2023, as France, for example. President Hollande in the last COP raised that point. So this long-term vision and this pathway to 2050, it is very important to have it internally in our governmental strategy. And again, fully agree with President Calderon that we should not be fear of continue the discussion of the elimination of subsidies to fossil fuels, and also to discuss carbon pricing. There are unfortunately some countries that are against the discussion of carbon pricing. But that is also an unstoppable discussion. we are going to have, using different kinds of measures, some kind of carbon pricing measures. So we should be part of that discussion. So that is, for me, also very, very important to have it into consideration. And my last comment, it is the importance of having transparent and opening process. As you have just had here in the UAE, with this steering committee of this footprint initiative, in which by the steering committee and by putting together different positions, the country has approved a lighting policy and is discussing some in relation to vehicles. So that kind of process with open information and with public participation, it is very important. And let me move to my last comment. What is happening in the world? Why we are in this time of political uncertainty? What we have learned of the last decision in some places of the world? That people is seeking for a job and security. So we should reinforce our message that by working in this new low carbon economy, in this new climate economy, we are working for a job and security. So that is why it is very important what President Calderon has just raised. What is the rate of the growing of jobs in the renewable sector in comparison to the oil and gas? So we do need to reinforce that message to say to the people that we are working for them, for jobs and security. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And I think this last point actually relates to the one you made before around transparency, really being very clear what is the information behind, you know, what's the benefits, what are the opportunities, but then also, you know, what's the risks. So I think if people have actually the information and the tools to incorporate this information into their decision making, then that should be helping to get us to other business models. So I think this one, and certainly raising the ambition and using both the Paris and the SDG agenda as an opportunity there, I think is extremely important. But before coming back to President Calderon, I'm actually very happy to, you know, we've heard a lot about the important role of the private sector, to have, again, Master here on the panel and really get the perspective of a company in this context and what is needed in order to further step up and to scale and replicate some of the business models that have been working. So I'm very happy to invite Mohamed Al-Ramahi again, the Chief Executive Officer of Master, to share some of the experiences, what works in Master and what you need in order to do more.
Thank you. I'm happy to represent the private sector, if you don't mind. Well, I think strategy, policy, and regulation is crucial for capital flows. So I want to speak from Masdar's experience, for instance. We have celebrated our 10th year anniversary, and we have deployed $2.7 billion. Now, in the early days of our life, we have deployed that capital into countries that had a mature and clear policy, regulation, which allowed our capital to flow into. Of course, each independent investment has its own characteristics, it has its own risk, and these risks will require a certain return. If it's attractive to us, then we will deploy. But frankly, in the past, let's say 5 years, a lot of things have changed. In the early years, it was Europe for our own capital and the United Arab Emirates, because the UAE was a pioneer in advancing renewable energy targets here in our region. But today, you see opportunities across the whole region, the MENA region in particular, the GCC, North Africa, the Levant region, and India. These opportunities are there because of regulations and policies. Now, for us as investors and developers, we will not deploy any single dollar if we do not feel that this dollar is secured. And this dollar will allow us to generate the profitability that our shareholders seek. Now, renewable energy has been, in the beginning, it's a fact, costly in the early years of renewables. And because of that cost, Masdar had to really swim against the current in a lot of places. But today, I can assure you that renewable energy is not because of the policy that has been put in place, but because it is really commercially viable and it can compete with conventional power generation on a standalone basis. And it does not only compete on a standalone basis, but for a developer and investor, it actually gives us the required return that we seek. So we are happy to see and to be part of this evolution. But again, without the policies and the politicians and the regulator who are sitting next on my right, we as the private sector, we will not be able to do what we are doing today. But finally, I would just to highlight something very important. Policy is important. The appetite for investors and developers like us is crucial. But third, which is really, really an ingredient that if it's not there, then the whole thing will fall, is financing. The ability to get and to obtain financing for these projects. Now, you could, as a country, for example, could have an excellent policy, a regulation that allows private investors to come in, and you know, we come in, and then we realize that we are unable to obtain financing. And obviously, this is a major obstacle, and therefore, these three ingredients are critical and important. And finally, we will not be sitting here today talking about policy, talking about investment, and talking about financing without the brain power and those scientists who allowed us to actually develop and invest in these technologies. So all of this great initiatives that we have seen and these great successes is because of these brain power, these scientists who are sitting in the universities in a research center somewhere, really putting their efforts and their brain capacity in enhancing these efficiencies. So I really want to thank them.
Great. Thank you so much for that. And I think it very nicely shows, your comments very nicely show that there has been a lot of progress in terms of policies in many countries, in terms of, you know, thinking about some, you know, having the scientists that come up with the innovative technologies, with the solutions that can help us get scale, but there is still a bottleneck in terms of the financing, and so I think there is really something where we gotta continue to work across the different stakeholder groups to really, you know, enable the right solutions that can get us to scale, because that is what we do need. So thank you so much for that. But let me turn back now to President Calderon, just for some additional reflections after you've heard the panel here talking and how that, you know, links back to the work also in the new climate economy that you have been leading, and in thinking a little bit more about, you know, some maybe concrete examples that you've observed in that work, and where you can see that there's been really some leadership, because I guess this is what in the end we need to try to replicate around the world.
Well, I already talk a lot, but some comments made. One is we need to change the whole idea about doing the right thing is painful and costly, because the skeptical side of the world, to say that, believes that. And we need to talk about the future, and we need to talk about, as I said, about the promised land of the new climate economy, instead to go back to all those boring speeches related with the catastrophe and the apocalypse of the climate change. Of course, I do believe in what is going to happen if we don't act. But a lot of people don't like to talk about it. Maybe they are blind related with the threats, but maybe they could be more interested in what is going to happen in the future. So the benefits are across the board, to say. And let me start with the consumers, for instance. In my home, me as consumer in my home, as we the Mexicans say, your home, I was paying like a lot of money for my electricity bill. So I changed for solar panels in the roof, and I'm paying right now 10% of what I was paying before. Of course, as you were saying, And of course, among brackets, I need to add to my favorite agencies, to IRENA, and I replicate what Mr. Amin said. The problem with the renewable energy is the upfront cost of that. It's a capital intensive investment, so we need to finance, we need to fix the finance problem, and we will fix the equation. Second is good for producers, and it implies that, for instance, retrofit buildings, to say, it is explored that in Philadelphia, for instance, retrofit increases the price of buildings on average 15%, just changing, for instance, the isolations of the walls and the air conditioning and the windows and so on. And the price for rent increases by 5% on average in the whole city of Philadelphia. So it is good for profits, good for business. That's the whole idea. And it is possible to alleviate poverty and what Energy for All, for instance, or all those projects related with distributed energy projects in Africa, sub-Saharan Africa, they were quite important because it alleviates the poverty, alleviates the condition of the people. So we need to talk and we need to decide about the benefits. If you explore, most of the saving energy measures everywhere are positive net present value. Positive net present value, meaning you can reduce carbon emissions, and most of the time you make a lot of money saving energy. So we need to do that, and it's quite simple things everywhere. So finally, just I want to jump into this. What are the barriers for financing? In our third report of the Global Commission on the Economy and Climate, we identify like five big blocks, five big barriers for financing. One is unfavorable regulation. And yes, this implies that several things. One is subsidies in carbon, in subsidies in fossil fuels, that is unfavorable regulations. Second is tax uncertainty. If one government provides, for instance, incentives for renewable energy, and following government just impose incredible taxes, this lack of certainty is terrible for any investment. Third, lack of certainty implying lack of predictability in the future. The lack of commitment, long-term predictability is crucial to it prevents investment. Second, and I already mentioned it, there are not enough bankable projects. A lot of countries have an incredible potential. Whenever you have money to that, or there are a lot of people looking for that money, they cannot find the bankable project. They have the idea, they have some suggestions, quite enthusiastic and creative people suggesting the project, but it's not bankable, no? There are no numbers in the paper. There are no guarantees, there are not, the project finance is not built properly for the bank. So we need to increase human capacity to do so. Third, there is not adequate returns, as you were saying, so this is risky, definitely. So it increases the cost of money financing the project. In the case of India, for instance, the price of the cost of financing is one of the main barriers for widespread solar energy, because you need to pay like a 20 interest rates beyond the commercial interest rate. So we need to develop banks and governments could enhance and guarantee such kind of projects in order to reduce the financial cost of that. And if we can fix the financial thing, we can fix the problem. Fourth is lack of viable funding models for sustainable infrastructure. And finally, high transactional cost for development. And including those transactional costs is lack of certainty, corruption, lack of transparency, and lack of capacity, for instance, to do the right bids or the right actions among the countries. One of the things that IRENA was saying in the recent report, I read that in the news already 2 days ago, is, yes, we are getting incredible prices for renewable energy in auction after auction, but take care of that, because it's like a racing cars. I like very much Formula One, for instance, like a capital scene for renewable people, but anyway. If you can speed a lot, no? And you can get 340 kilometers per hour, no? Here in the Abu Dhabi circuit, yes. But if you pass the maximum velocity, the maximum speed, you can get away to a track. So all those companies are getting incredible speed in terms of quite competitive cost, but take care, because if they move beyond their own long-term capacity, those companies could not afford, and we will be in bigger problems later, years later.
Great. Thank you so much, President. And I'm afraid I will have to cut this very insightful panel discussion here. Again, I think it's been very clear that there are many opportunities going forward for governments, business, and industry to really collaborate and get us towards scale. Getting the risk and returns right and having the right policy enabling environment obviously is key behind that one. But I think the ingredients are here, and key to really make the recipe work will be the leadership, as you've laid it out there. So I think it is time to raise ambition, to really get the leaders to step up, exceed the goals, as Minister Goel has anticipated already. So we're looking forward to seeing the news on that one. And one last point before I'm going to close from Adan.
It's also my guilty pleasure, Formula One. But I'm now converted to Formula E, and I want to invite President Calderon to the first Formula E race in Dubai, January 2018. And we have to switch to electric mobility.
Yeah, with pleasure, and Mexico will be in April. You will be very welcome.
Well, thank you so much, and please join me in thanking the panel for a wonderful discussion. Thank you.